Hey, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by Ogio Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm Don Maeda and I'm joined today by Ricky Brabec, who just pretty much got home from Saudi Arabia from winning the 2020 Dakar Rally. So like, do I have to like call you sir now, or are you like have a special title?
No, just Ricky's fine, normal person. This was just another day at the office.
It's kind of funny to hear you just downplay it like it's just another race, but Dakar is considered by most people in motorsports to be the largest race in the world, right?
Yeah, the most prestigious race in the world. You know, it hasn't been really well known here in America. Mm-hmm. You know, now since I've been in the Dakar, last year obviously we were really close. So I think it's been on the radar in America, and I think, you know, people are starting to watch it and get connected to it a little bit more. It is only once a year that it's on TV, so that's what makes it so prestigious. You know, there's 360 something days before we can go back and do it again.
Yeah.
And to bring it home is really nice.
Yeah. So how does a guy from the high desert of Southern California end up racing rallies all over the world?
That I don't know. You know, I started out racing bicycles as a kid. Mm-hmm. We moved to the high desert when I was about 15. Went to, did my first like off-road race in 2007, was a Hare and Hound, which mm-hmm. I have two championships in. You know, it's all with flags and arrows and dangers.
Yeah.
Ever since then, you know, I was going to Baja, checking it out, Best in Desert, checking it out. And then 2015, I got a phone call from Quinn Cody asking me if I would be interested in learning rally. Mm-hmm. So it kind of started there. And then I went to my first rally in 2015 with HRC. Mm-hmm. They liked me, so they brought me back again. And then they liked my second audition, I guess.
Yeah.
And then they brought me back again, which would be 2016 Dakar, which was my first Dakar. Mm-hmm. And before this year was my first Dakar and the only Dakar I finished out of the last 5 years until 2020.
The invitation to do rally, was rally something you had your sights on eventually, or was it just kind of like, oh, yeah, that's a cool opportunity, I'll do that. I mean, because that's got to be a daunting invitation. I mean, rally's a big thing.
Yeah, and, you know, rally, some of us watch rally, you know, we watch Dakar every year. I was watching Dakar, you know, it was really cool. We were watching Robbie Gordon, Quinn Cody, mm-hmm. Johnny Campbell, you know, in my era of watching it. It was really nice, you know, but at that time, it's like, how does a guy from California or America make it there, you know?
Yeah.
From what I saw, it was like, man, it's really expensive. You know, the bikes aren't even the same as what mm-hmm. we ride. Yeah, I got the call and I was like, I jumped right on it, you know? No hesitation, I just went for it, you know? I told Quinn, like, yeah, I'll learn, you know? It sounds fun.
Yeah.
And we went for it, but it's not something that you can just go drive your truck to, pull your bike out, sign up, race, and go home, you know? Mm-hmm. It's a big program to get on to.
How many people are, because I saw the victory photo, right? And it looked like 50 people involved in it. I mean, what is the staff like that's involved in putting a rally effort?
Yeah, so us as HRC, we bring about 35 people.
Wow.
Yeah, and like every rider has a helper. So my helper is Johnny Campbell. Mm-hmm. Every rider has a mechanic. And then obviously there's like a rider manager, a team manager. We bring, you know, a couple Japanese that actually like built the bike, you know, from scratch. Mm-hmm. We have an engine guy, chassis guy. We have basically a guy for every part of the motorcycle. Then we have our parts truck. Parts truck has a helper. We have a chief mechanic. We have, you know, two massage therapists. We have a media guy. Mm-hmm. And it takes like a family, like a small village to get this to go, because it's a traveling circus. And every day we go point A to point B. It's not like a stationary spot where we just race out of every single day. So we have to have all these people unload everything, load everything back up, drive the next day. So it's like I said, it's a moving circus.
Yeah.
Takes a lot of people.
What was the learning curve like? I mean, you know, two national Hare and Hound championships, you know, obviously amazing motorcycle rider, but there's things to learn about strategy and planning and reading the terrain. I'm sure that was all new to you.
Yeah, there's a lot to learn. Reading terrain comes from national Hare and Hounds or just trail riding in the hills. Motocross is also good for some practice. You know, it's motocross is good for, you know, every kind of discipline that you're into. Rally, the strategy, it's, I've been doing it 5 years, you know, so mm-hmm. I've been learning every year. You learn how to do it and how to do something different or how to make it easier. Definitely, you know, you want to place yourself in a good position for the next day. So that's part of the strategy. Mm-hmm. You need to know what day you can push, what day you can lose a little bit of time, because in reality, you don't really want to open the stage, meaning you don't want to start first because there's no tracks. You have to fry your brain by reading the road book and really concentrating extra. Where if you start back, you have a couple lines in front of you. You know, there's, we're racing through sand dunes, sand washes, mm-hmm. just the desert. So it's not like there's a lot of people out there riding motorcycles. So obviously, you know, seeing a motorcycle line, you're like, ah, we need to go this way. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of strategy, you know, and you learn over the years. Obviously, 5 years, I've kind of figured it out, but I have Johnny that can also help me and Jimmy Lewis that can help me, along with like our rider manager that can help me. Hey, you need to push this day, or you need to like slow down a little bit. Mm-hmm. But it's a lot. It's not just racing wide open, you know, yeah. every day.
When you say you don't want to go out first, it's not a mass start, right? It's like people are on time, but how do you earn your starting time? Like, you know, you don't want to go first.
Yeah. So each day you finish is your starting position for the next day.
Yeah.
So the top 10 guys start 3 minutes apart. 10 to 20 start 1 minute apart, and then 20 on is 30 seconds every two bikes. So if I start first and you start 10th and you catch me in the stage somehow mm-hmm. because I make a mistake, you just made 30 minutes on me basically. Mm-hmm. So your goal is, when you start first, your goal is to obviously go as fast as you can and make no mistakes, because there's people behind you that can follow your tracks and it's mm-hmm. much easier. Mm-hmm.
Is there qualifying? How do you sandbag so you're not the first guy out every day?
How do you sandbag?
No, but the first day at the start of it, say.
The first, you can't do anything about that.
Okay. Is it like a luck of the draw thing?
No, it's like, so this year was the top 25 elite riders mm-hmm. started in reverse order.
Okay.
So it went 25, 24, you know, and so on to one. So Toby was number one. He started last on the whole day. Mm-hmm. So he had, you know, a lot of tracks. I was number nine, so I was 14 or something to go. Mm-hmm. So after that, you just get through the first day. And then after that, you know, your strategy can start playing in, like, you know, I push this day and I push that day. Now I'm opening tomorrow because I just won. Mm. And I know that there's people that are 12, 15 minutes behind me that are gonna catch me.
Yeah.
So now that they start in front of you the following day, now you're back. Now typically, yeah, you're gonna push to try to catch time. But when you get closer to the end, you need to have strategy so you're not starting in the front losing time.
Yeah.
So normally we have fuel stops. And we have 15 minutes. And our GPS, you know, is, you know, yay big. We have 15 minutes. You can get fuel. And if your other components or your other, you know, people are there that you need to beat or you need to catch, mm-hmm. you check their GPS time to see, like, how much time you've made up or how mm-hmm. much time you've lost. Because if you don't want to start first the next day, then you need to, on the second part of the stage, you need to hold back a little bit. Mm-hmm. And if you're like, man, they're smoking me today. The second part, you need to like really push.
Yeah. Wow. Sounds like a lot to learn, man.
It's a lot.
Yeah. Hey, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors, but we'll be back for more with Ricky Brabec. Hey guys, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by Ogio Powersports and FMF Racing. Here with Dakar winner Ricky Brabec. So, okay, a few months ago, we're at Milestone, I'm riding, and you go blowing by me on your full rally bike, right? And you're passing this tight turn. I had time to look over and see all the stuff on your handlebars and the roll chart and all that. I guess we'll talk about you riding at a local track on that later, but there is so much going on your handlebars. And so in addition to hauling ass, avoiding rocks, flying in a ditch, you have to like navigate and read off this chart and stuff, right?
Yeah.
That's gnarly.
Yeah, you know, it's a navigation tower. So on top of the tower, we have an odometer. And then next to the odometer, we have a cap heading or a cap meter, which is a cap heading, you know, from 0 to 360. Under that, we have our roll chart, which is paper, mm-hmm. You know, has an odometer. Yeah, yeah. It has an odometer on the left. The middle has like an arrow of what direction you're gonna go. And then on the far right box, it's dangers or just additional information. Then below that, you know, we have another ICO, which you can have a speedometer or a mileage, but I use a speedometer. Mm-hmm. And then below that, actually mounted to our bars, is a GPS unit that I was talking about with the time.
Yeah.
That eventually we get an arrow only when we get a certain amount of meters to a waypoint. And yeah, then between waypoint to waypoint, there's no arrow. Like, we're just navigating. And on the handlebars, we have a thumb switch for our roll chart that we have to match our mileage up to.
Yeah.
And then next to our thumb switch, we have like speed control buttons for speed zones. Then we have like buttons to adjust our odometer. Then we have a button to change our clock / speedometer / odo. Mm-hmm. And then we have, you know, a fuel switch for front tanks or back tanks. And then we have a mapping switch. So we have like traction control or no traction control.
How do you look at all that stuff when you're going 100 miles an hour and it's bouncing up and down, right?
That's the hard part. Like when you're on a rough road that has like the chatter bumps.
Yeah.
Yeah, your tower's just like, you're trying to read it, you know? But after the years, after, you know, training, you learn like when to look down and what to look at when you're looking down. So, mm-hmm. I mean, if you're gonna go out your first time, you're gonna be like this the whole time, you know, like you don't know what you're gonna be looking at the paper and not looking where you're going. But yeah, eventually you get more immune to it. And yeah, you're gonna go. And when you can look down, you're gonna look down at the odometer, look back up and look down and see like what the cap heading is, just mm-hmm. so you can like, when you get there, you can see what direction you're gonna go.
Yeah, wow.
And obviously you're gonna look for dangers.
So you said there's like a danger dial or something, or it tells you of hazards?
Yeah, in the road book, in the, you know, on the paper, it'll put, so the dangers are exclamation points. Mm-hmm. Single danger is one, doubles two, triples three, and then like three is the worst. Two, sometimes you slow down for them and sometimes you don't. Mm-hmm. And then one, normally, depending on who made the road book, normally one, you don't even lift or anything. It's just like, yeah, a small undulation or something.
What is a typical three?
Typical three is like,
something, or?
Yeah, like if you're going down a fast road, a typical three would be like a 12-foot deep rain rut across the whole thing, like something that'll really put you in the hospital or something. Yeah.
Wow. Have you had any close calls in the rallies with like something like that?
I've had close calls in the rallies with stuff that's not even marked as a danger.
Really?
Yeah. This rally 2020, no, I had, my closest call was in a corner going 20 miles an hour, was like a rain rut, you know, and I was just going slow. It was like a U-turn and I just hit it and the bike bottomed out and like kind of bounced up. But other than that, no dangers. My bike hit the ground two times and was in the sand dunes both times.
Yeah, I read an article about the rally, and you said that you gave your mechanic back a perfect bike every night because you only had two tip overs in the sand.
Yeah, you know, my mechanic, Colonel Norman, he gave me a perfect bike every morning, and I delivered a perfect bike to him every evening. I think we smashed three skid plates, I think, and that was it. Other than that, change oil, filter, tires.
Yeah.
No scratches, nothing. It was the perfect rally.
Okay, when you tip over in the sand, like How much does that bike weigh with all that stuff on it? I know it's probably lighter than we would all assume, but is it tough to get it back up?
Yeah, when you fall over like in a soft spot, like a soft patch, and you're like definitely on like a peak of a dune, dude, to pick that bike up, you know, because you're not going to pick it up from standing above it. You know, you got to go under it, swing it around, pick it up. It's 400 pounds.
Oof. Yeah.
It's heavy. Sometimes you get it up like a little bit on your side and it's already started and in gear. You pick it up, get it on your side, and then you just like throttle out of it. So like that way to like stand up for you.
Yeah.
And then you're running next to your bike and you just jump on it.
Okay. So the rally was 12 days, right?
Yeah.
And how many hours a day are you in the saddle typically?
In the saddle each day, minimum 8 hours.
8 hours.
Yeah.
Okay. So when you're hauling ass, do you like pull over to go to the bathroom, or are you wearing like a catheter thing out your boot, or you just wet your pants?
Okay, I've never peed my pants in the rally.
No.
I don't wear a catheter. Some people do.
Yeah.
But in the special, we have sometimes some speed zones. So it's weird, and people are gonna laugh at me, but in a speed zone, sometimes I like put my knee on the seat and like unzip my pants while I'm in the speed zone, and then I just pee like all over the side of my bike.
Uh-huh.
And then I'm like in the speed zone trying to like zip my pants up, you know? But I know my teammate Nacho peed in his pants, so I don't know if I can do that.
Yeah.
I feel like I would get like a brash, you know, like
monkey butt going, right?
Monkey butt would be way worse if you peed, you know?
What if you ate like some like spicy nachos the night before?
Oh, yeah, I've never had that problem at a rally, but I could imagine, dude, because you're in the bike all day, you know, sometimes you're sitting down and it's like, if you're trying to hold it and sitting down, you're like, you know?
Yeah.
But normally, you know, we try to take care of business before we start, mm-hmm. but sometimes, you know, it doesn't happen.
Yeah.
So luckily I haven't been there.
So I was like kind of Googling some stuff, and I found a YouTube video that was just like 2020 Dakar Ricky Brabec best footage. And it was just all helicopter footage of you riding, and I'm just watching, and it was really intriguing for me to watch. Like some of it looked like your intensity level is a little bit lower, and then some you're hauling ass, and then there's another clip of you chasing a guy in the dunes. But when I think of rally, it's like, oh, hours on end of being alone and, you know, scary, and you know, you could die out there and everything. But is there like a helicopter following you a lot of the time? Like, are you ever really truly alone?
This was the first Dakar that I wasn't truly alone. Like all the other years, if you start a little bit far back, the chances of you catching the front, like the front group. So if you start first, for sure, two people are gonna catch you and then you'll be together.
Yeah.
But if you start back, sometimes you can have a 500 mile day and see nobody.
Really?
Yeah. And then the helicopter, obviously, you know, they're there to film. So they'll get a little shot of you here and there, but no, it's not like a Mexico race where you have a helicopter like buzzing over you the whole time.
Yeah.
But the GPS units that we have on our navigation tower, they're really good. They can tell if your bike has been, you know, leaned over for 30 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And if your bike hasn't moved in 3 minutes, like they're already sending a helicopter.
So it's safe.
No, but they're aware, you know, like they know if your bike hasn't moved in 3 minutes and you haven't pushed any button, mm-hmm. then they assume, oh, you know, he's knocked out,
mm-hmm.
something happened, and they'll be there within 8 minutes.
Yeah.
Because this Dakar, I think we have like 12 helicopters spread out on the route.
Mm-hmm.
Like they're sitting there waiting, you know, for emergencies.
Yeah. Wow. Wait, we're going to take another quick break. Yeah. We'll be back for one more segment with Ricky Brabec.
What's up, guys? It's Brock Tickle, and I'm getting things ready and lined up for 2020. I'm stoked to be with FXR this year. The gear is awesome, fits me well, and the pants are the best fitting pants I've ever worn. Just the fit and how the panels are, it really does fit me really well. I'm preparing for my comeback season at Tampa Supercross for Ty Lube AEO Brock Tickle Racing. Please don't slow down.
Don't try to be the fastest on the track.
Be the fastest ever. Work harder than everyone else.
Because dedication is everything.
If they say your goals are crazy, be insane.
Be fast.
Be the crazy one. Be unstoppable. One goal, one vision.
We have four colors right now. Retails for $28.95 at odigrips.com and of course, your favorite retailer.
We put our heads together to both reimagine and lift the bar on what a modern motocross helmet should be. Opt for the highest level of modern technology and energy dispersion with the Fly Racing Formula helmet. Designed for an elevated defense against a wider range of real-world impact scenarios. Globally engineered with the most advanced materials and technologies available. Outfit yourself with proven technology, lightweight performance, and elevated impact management with the Fly Racing Formula helmet.
Hey, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by Ogio Powersports and FMF Racing. Here with Ricky Brabec. Earlier, I alluded to the day at Milestone. Well, there's a couple days, actually, when you just blow by me on the motocross course on your full rally bike. Was that just kind of a training thing for you to just ride that bike at all times and get used to it?
So, yeah, I mean, I've been riding the rally bike almost for every discipline of riding, moto, trails, high speed, you know, anything. Just so I can feel, I wanted to feel more natural on the bike, you know. Sometimes, or some racers only get to ride the rally bike at the race. So for me, you know, obviously they're a lot different than a motocross bike.
Yeah.
So I was able to bring a rally bike home. And yeah, I go to the moto track, you know, you want to know what your bike's going to do in every situation.
Yes.
So motocross track, you have ruts, jumps, mud. You know, the desert, you have dry, slippery, single track. You want to know what your bike's going to do in every situation. Mm-hmm. So the motocross track, obviously, I just go there to have fun. I don't train at the motocross track. Mm-hmm. I'll ride until I get arm pump, then I'll pull over. But no, it's pretty cool to ride the big bike on the track. It handles, you know, surprisingly really good.
Mm-hmm.
And the plus side is when you're getting smoked by all these little kids, you got a fairing to hide behind so you don't get roosted as bad.
Oh, man. How much fuel does the bike hold?
The bike holds almost 9 gallons.
Okay, so chuck full to almost empty, it handles drastically different then, right?
Yeah, correct.
Do you have to think about that when you're riding and approaching an obstacle? Like, well, it's early in the day, I got a lot of fuel.
Yeah, for sure. When you're completely full, and sometimes there's big stages where the bike is barely gonna make it. You know, for instance, we had a 230 kilometer dune day before refueling. We were full, like to the max where the gas is dripping out.
Yeah.
I showed up with 2 liters. 2 liters is half a gallon.
Mm-hmm.
So when you start in the morning full, you typically wanna take it easy for about 30 minutes and burn down. You know, I burn down the front a little bit because the front's a little bit high.
Mm-hmm.
So I want that weight as low as I can. And the back tank, we sit on it, so it's low already.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, you have to definitely be careful. And then when the bike's empty, oh dude, you can moto the thing. It's so much lighter, I should say.
Yeah. So when you were going to like a motocross track, you only put 2 gallons in?
Yeah. Yeah, I take all the rear is empty and I put 2 gallons in the front.
Really?
Yeah.
Weight the front in a little bit?
Well, just the back, because it's a rally spec suspension, so it's kind of soft.
Mm-hmm.
And if I have fuel in the back on the motocross track, it'll, you know, will hit really hard.
Yeah.
So yeah, I just 2 gallons, check the gas every time I go out. But if you were full on a motocross track, oh dude, you on the landings of every jump, you'd see like a big skid plate drag.
Yeah. Okay, so during the rally, I understand you only get like a small window at the end of each day to do some maintenance on the bike, right?
No.
Or is overnight?
Yeah, so in a rally, we have, you know, a normal day where the mechanics can work on the bike all night.
Oh, okay.
Then we have a day or a stage called Super Marathon, which Super Marathon is, our bikes are basically an impound. We have 10 minutes to work on them, and they're an impound in the middle of the desert, but we can sleep with our crew, our team. Then we have a day called Marathon, which is we sleep remote out in the middle of nowhere. We don't see our team at all. We don't have any parts, and we can work on our bike more than 10 minutes. But either way, Super Marathon or Marathon, we don't, I mean, what are you going to work on your bike? We carry levers and like an exhaust mount.
Yeah.
So we can't really work on much, you know, we don't have extra rims or bars or anything. So typically you want to race, you know, you have a marathon day is day one and two with no maintenance. So you need to make your bike last for 2 days, basically with no mechanics help. And just, you have to really take care of your motorcycle, you know, because you don't want to crash on day one. And then when you have no help,
bent bars.
Yeah, you don't want to ride the whole second day with, you know, yeah, bent bars, broken tower,
yeah,
et cetera. So those 2 days, you know, so this rally, we had two marathons. So it's 4 days where we were riding bikes that were kind of not hurt, but not fresh, you know?
Yeah.
So you have to really be careful.
What about like air filters? Do you carry one with you and
change it
on those days?
Yeah, we have an air filter, like a twin air, you know, we have like a guy that rolls it up. It looks like a little hot dog. Yeah, we zip tie it to our tower. But in a rally, it's not like Baja or Hare and Hound where you're just fighting in the dust all day, you know? If you're in the dust in rally, you just back off and, you know, you just ride smart.
Yeah.
So normally we don't change air filters. But sometimes, yeah, if we need to, we'll pull the skin off and check it and then do a filter.
Yeah. Okay, so at the end of the day, I'm sure you hydrate and you eat. Is it like you're so beat tired, just like out, fall asleep? Or is it like there are times when you're struggling to get your rest?
For some people, it's hard. You know, obviously, we, you know, as an elite rider, we start early in the morning and we're done the earliest. So we have some time to rest. This Dakar, I was never like super beat to where I needed a nap. But also, this Dakar was a new era. We got our road book delivered to us in the morning, 25 minutes before we started, on 6 days. So when we get our road book the next day, it's really nice because we can go to the bivouac, is what we call like the main hub. We can go to the bivouac and we don't have a road book to mark. We can just sit in the motorhome and relax and just hang out and talk. So having the road book delivered the next day is really relaxing. Then when we get the road book right after we finish, you got 3 hours of looking through it, painting, and yeah, basically getting tired.
Yeah. What do you, how do you fuel yourself? Like, what do you eat at night? And I'm sure you eat during the day, right?
So we leave at 4 a.m, sometimes, you know, 3:50 in the morning. Johnny was there helping me, cooking breakfast for me, and he would cook lunch for us when we got back to the bivouac. And then for the nighttime, we would eat the bivouac food, which, I mean, if you follow my stories, it's not like the best. But in the jacket, yeah, we carry like, I carried beef jerky, peanut butter, some honey stinger waffle, some gummy bears, multivitamin pills, salt pills, some ibuprofen, just, you know, because you're out there all day, dude, you don't know.
Yeah.
Sometimes not enough food, and then sometimes you don't even touch your food because you don't have time.
Yeah. So, you know, you've kind of said that this was a pretty smooth rally for you, like no crashes. And how tired were you at the end? Was it just like, I mean, are you in such great shape that it was just like another race, or is rally the most physically taxing thing of the year?
Rally is, it's difficult in a different way. It's not riding supercross. It's not riding motocross. It's not riding Hare and Hounds or Baja. It's tiring in a different way as far as like you're mentally fatigued from reading the road book all day. You're averaging 4 hours a night of sleep. And then you're on a bike all day. You're not eating close to how much you're burning, you know? So at the end, you get tired. At the end of this rally, I wasn't fatigued as far as my body. I just couldn't wait to get to the end and sleep without earplugs.
I had to sleep with plugs because it's...
Yeah, man, the bivouac is a confined area. It'd be like sleeping in the Walmart parking lot every night.
Yeah.
With bike teams, quad teams, side-by-side teams, truck teams, trash truck teams, and just, dude, those guys don't show up till like 8 o'clock at night. Then they got to grind their chassis, bang their skid plate with a sledgehammer, weld it back on. Dude, it's all night you hear this stuff. So yeah, you have to sleep with your plugs, and sometimes they're right next to you and you don't get any sleep.
Yeah. Wow. Hey, last question. When you come home from Saudi Arabia, Dakar winner, first American rider to ever win, Honda rider who breaks KTM's, what, it's like 13 or 18 year?
I think it's 18.
18 year stranglehold on the rally. What do you reward yourself with?
Right when I got home, I had pizza and a couple drinks.
That's it? You didn't go buy a toy or something?
Oh, dude, not yet.
Not yet.
I've been busy since I've been home.
On this whole media tour coming down,
yeah.
Paying the ass shows like this.
Yeah, but for sure, I don't know. I need a vacation. Mm-hmm. Maybe I'll buy a side-by-side. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, cool, man. Whatever it is, you definitely deserve it. Thanks for coming on the show. It's an honor to have you here.
Yeah, thank you.
Maybe I'll see you at Santa's Village jumping mountain bikes again, huh?
Oh, I cannot. I get new bikes on Friday from Trek. I cannot wait to go to Santa's Village. And if you guys haven't been, you should go.
Yeah. Right on, buddy.
Yep.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming on.
Yep.
Yeah, so give Ricky Brabec a follow on Instagram. Do you have a YouTube? Do you do all that stuff?
No. Just Instagram. Have no YouTube.
Okay. Well, hey, check him out. Watch him next year in the 2021 Dakar Rally. Going to go for win number 2. And yeah, check out swapmotolive.com on the regular. Put in your bookmarks. And we'll see you next time.